Dumelang and welcome to Brandtegy, a combination of branding and strategy. On this platform, we're going to be sharing content relating to branding as well as service design. Today, we're going to be focusing on service design, looking at business model canvas. Now, this is part two of the business model canvas video. Do make sure that you watch part one of it because there we focus on what business models are, the importance of business models, as well as cover the first three building blocks of the business model canvas, being customer segments, customer relationships, as well as value proposition. So let's start now with part two of the video, focusing on the six remaining building blocks of a business model canvas. So we're gonna start with the fourth one being now channels. I think that it's important that you understand customer journey in order for you to identify what kind of channels are you going to use to make sure that people know about your product or service. So on a customer journey, the first part is awareness. Like, how do people become aware of your product or service, right? So this could be through a Facebook ad, Twitter, Instagram, or your website, TV ad, radio ad, newspaper, posters, word of mouth, or any other marketing channel that they become aware of your product on. So that's the awareness part. Then people start doing now research about your product. So people can go to reviews, you know, to find out more about your product or service. And they can also use the same channels that they use to become aware of your product, also to do the research part. So you need to make sure that these channels are on point. Then we come to the selection or the purchasing part of the customer journey process. So there you ask yourself, what channel am I using to actually make sure that people buy my product? Are they buying online? Are they going to the physical store to actually buy the product or service? Then we come to the delivery part. Are people coming to the physical store to actually collect their product or service? Or do you have a delivery channel where you actually deliver the products to the people, right? And then we've got the follow-up. So this is the part, you ask yourself, what channel am I making sure that I am still in touch with my customers even after they've bought my product or bought my service, right? So you could have like a database where you've got people's contact details and keep communicating with them, sending them SMSs, sending them emails, or any form of communication as long as it's after sales. So what channel are you using to make sure that you follow up with your people? So now that we are done with channels, let's move on to the next building block, which is key resources. So you could have physical resources, for example, machinery, equipment, the actual physical store or the vehicles that you need for your business. Or you could have intellectual resources, for example, copyrights and patents, databases, and the actual brand can be an intellectual resource. Human resources are the actual people that you hire to work at your company or business. The financial one, let's say for example, your business is heavily reliant on you getting a loan or you getting finances from someone in order for you to operate. So that's a financial resource. Then key activities, for example, production. If you have a business that actually designs clothes, right? So your key activity under production could be, you start by doing research on the latest fashion trends to make sure that you give people a value proposition of proper design. Then you start sketching it out, you know, start sketching out the design, then actually start sewing the dress or whatever item that you're designing, then taking it to market. So that's production activities. Or you could have problem solving activities. Let's just say you've got a firm and you go to other businesses to automate their manual processes. So you are solving their problems, right? So that's a problem solving activity. So number one, your key activity could be to train your employees, obviously to learn how to automate processes. And number two, the key activity could actually be going to get the client and actually going to the client to start automating their processes. And notice how the key activities have to be very linked to the value proposition. So if the value proposition is performance and cost reduction, you actually going to the client and automating their processes, you're already reducing their cost in a sense that you have a machinery performing a piece of work that human beings used to do. So you're no longer paying people to do that piece of work. Number two, in terms of performance, machines generally don't get tired. So there's high performance. They can work 24/7 as long as they are maintained. There's high performance and they are more reliable. They're not prone to like human mistakes, right? So these activities have to be very linked to value proposition because people pay for value, right? So if they're not linked to this, you're not making money. Then platform-based activities, for example, could be when you've got an online store that sells Louis Vuitton, right? So your value proposition could be accessibility. What this means is that now people in the Northern Cape, people in the Eastern Cape, people in every province can start having access to Louis Vuitton that can actually be delivered to their home. So your value proposition is accessibility. And the key activities that you have to be based on the actual platform, right? So for example, number one, you have to pay your internet service provider to make sure that the platform is always accessible 24/7. Number two, you have to keep updating the website with the latest fashion trends, right? So you have to delete some of the old things that are not available. You have to update the new ones, you know, and make sure that they appear first. So your activities have to be very platform-based. Then moving on to key partners, you could have strategic alliance with non-competitors. I love this one because I did it in varsity, right? So I had a business called OnFlick Solutions, and it was selling hair, it was doing makeup, doing nails. Then I had a friend who was in the photography business. So we joined together, we had a strategic alliance, and we were non-competitors. Because we knew, for example, with graduates, if I was doing the graduates' makeup, they'd also need photography. So we joined together. So what the advantages that we had is that I no longer had to pay a designer to actually create a poster for me so we can put around campus, because my friend who was in photography knew how to design. So at least I could reduce cost in that sense. Then in terms of also the people who are on my page, I had like 1,000 followers, and she had also 1,000 followers on her Facebook page. It means that we had now more scope, right, to reach more people. It means that instead of me just reaching 1,000 people, I could now reach 2,000 people. She could also reach 2,000 people. So that is strategic alliance or strategic partners with non-competitors. You can also have strategic alliance with competitors, right? Say for example, you've got 5 people who own who are in the business of photography or videography, right? And they each have 2 cameras to take videos of people, right? If just the 2 people combine their business together, it means that they are combining their resources together in as much as they are competitors. But now instead of having 2 cameras, they have an advantage of having 4 cameras as partners, as opposed to all the other 3 who now just each have 2 cameras. So their value proposition now strengthens, because when they go to clients, they can now say, you know, we can take videos from different angles. So that's strategic alliance with competitors. So you can become partners with your competitors. Joint ventures, for example, say for example, I bought land and it's got like gold and diamonds and all these cool resources, but I don't have the resources to actually mine the diamond, to actually mine the gold or the platinum. I can join with a mine that has those resources, and we create a joint venture so that I can use their resources to actually mine, and they're also using obviously my resources on my land. Then we build a joint venture. Buyer-supplier relationship could be if I've got a hair salon and I'm doing people's hair. Obviously, I need people to supply me with the hair so that I can start plating people's hair. Then, in terms of cost structures, you can either be a cost-driven business model, or you can have a value-driven business model. For example, if you are building a 7-star hotel, right? You can't be focusing on like cost and whatnot, because you have to deliver value. People, when they come to your hotel, they're going to be paying for value. So you're going to be a value-driven business. But if your value proposition is on price, you are focusing on delivering like products at low cost. So obviously then you're going to be a cost-driven, you're going to have a cost-driven business model in a sense that your inputs, right, your inputs for whatever you're producing, you're going to focus on like paying less for them so that the outputs can also be cheaper. So you can either have fixed cost or variable cost. Your fixed cost could be like people's salaries, rent, and variable cost is whatever cost that is not fixed, basically. Asset sale could be when I'm giving you ownership to the rights of a product or service, then you give me money in return. For example, if I'm selling you a car, you now own the car and I have your money. Usage fee could be paying for data, for airtime, because you're using those things, so you pay a usage fee for it. Subscription fee could be paying for your gym subscription for 3 months, for a year. Renting could be leasing out properties or leasing out cars. License fee could be leasing out, paying license fee for using specific software. Advertising could be paying SABC to advertise on their platform. brokerage fee, could be paying an insurance broker to actually give you and get you the cheapest insurance on the market, and then you pay them and they take a specific amount for actually being the middleman. So that is it on business model canvas. I hope that you're going to start developing your business model canvases for your own, for your new business, or reinventing one for your existing business. Till I see you again, bye.